Good morning, Pinelands. Our scripture reading for today is taken from Revelation chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. And you can find this in your bulletin insert. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." And the 24 elders who sit on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worship God, saying, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and begun to reign. The nations raged, but your wrath came, and the time for the dead to be judged, and for rewarding your servants, the prophets and saints, and those who fear your name, both small and great, and for destroying the destroyers of the earth." Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant was seen within his temple. There were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and heavy hail. Amen.
Father, we really desire to come here as little kids who are in need of you. It is so easy for the preacher and the audience and everyone else who would have a category of whatever to just come here like some highly functional, competent adult. But God, you said that unless you are converted as a child, you will never enter the kingdom. And so we come here with this posture of smallness, this posture of need. We don't know everything. We don't master everything. We are kids in your household. And so we pray that you would help us to think about ourselves, think about you, and think about this world around us in a way that makes the most Christ-exalting sense. Amen. Amen. So, last Sunday we talked about expectations. What are some expectations that we should expect as we are doing what we do? And what we're going to see now, as we have our expectations set, now we're going to see what is our finale that we are looking forward to. Now, interesting thing about Revelation is not a linear book. Revelation is more like a bunch of angles of the events of Christ's first and second coming. And so in some sense, you see the end of everything in Revelation like multiple times. This is not now. This is the second time we have come to see the end. We saw it first in chapter 6. The end happens. End time judgment. And now we see it again in this chapter 11. And before you begin to think, oh my gosh, eschatology, the things about end times, like I'm a mom and you know, who cares? Like that's just something that like you, like people like you and Yanni like to talk about, you know, I want to read something that I think is important about eschatology. 2 Peter 1:13. "Therefore, with your minds ready for action, be serious and set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ." So somehow, fix your minds completely on the return of Christ, and as obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires of your former ignorance. So that means that what you believe about the end affects your ethics and your behavior and your Christianity now. What you're looking towards affects your presence. Listen, if you're walking and you're looking towards a cliff, it's going to affect the way you walk as opposed to you see a bridge, right? If you're walking and you see a riot, it's going to affect what you do as you're walking there as opposed to seeing a festival. Do not get it twisted. Eschatology is not something that's going to make us right with God, but it certainly matters. What you believe about how things will end will affect the present. So here's the first thing that I want to do to give us a view of our finale is that when we see the end, we see cultural cessation. Cessation is just a way of things ending. We see cultural cessation, not continuation. CCC. You like that? "A violent earthquake took place and a tenth of the city fell and 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake." Now, 7,000 is not about, when Christ comes back, only 7,000 people are going to die. It's just speaking about the completeness of destruction that happens in the end. If you read the rest of these verses, you'll see that it's not just a partial end, but it is a final end. But when Christ comes back, the seventh trumpet is blown. Seven speaks about completeness. When Christ comes back, he is going to end and totally stop everything in reality and culture. There is going to be an end of creation, not a continuation. Christ is coming back to annihilate everything that is not in Christ, not continue anything. He's not coming to bring culture to its final angle. He's coming to undo culture in his return. Notice it says that the kingdom of the world has become. When Christ comes back, the world becomes God's kingdom all over the place. But before that, it's not. So when he comes back, he destroys everything. He doesn't continue everything. Now, let me tell you what this means. When God comes back, he's going to destroy America. He's not going to continue it. When God comes back, he's going to destroy the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. He's not going to continue it. When Christ comes back, he is going to destroy the justice system, the economy, the educational systems, the entertainment systems. He's going to destroy art and science, healthcare and hospitals, and the CDC. Every nonprofit agency, every institution will be destroyed, not continued. Is that fair enough to say? He is not going to continue things that are not in Christ. He's going to destroy every religion that's not true. Beloved, he's going to destroy every building. All your houses are going to be destroyed when Christ comes back. If they don't get destroyed before then. All this grass will be destroyed. All the trees. There will be nothing left. No oceans, no mountains. He will undo reality entirely when he comes back. Jesus says many times that it will be as in the days of Noah when Christ comes back. So what happened in Noah's day? The whole world ended, and it only ended one of two ways. Either ended for you in the boat or not in the boat. Beloved, there's only one solution to us. It's not improvement. It's not continuation. It's not a renovation. We must end. We either end not in a boat, but we end in Christ. We die with Christ. Or we find our final end and D-Day in Christ. We die with Christ, or we end with the catastrophe of God's judgment, where he ends everything outside of Christ. But everything must end. There is no continuation of things. Things must end. You either end in Christ, where you die with him and you're raised savingly, or you will end outside of Christ damningly, where things will cease that are not in Christ. Beloved, this is very interesting now, because all that conversation about cancel culture and restart, guess what? There's only a true canceling of culture and a true restart. And it's in Christ being your canceling you out and restarting in Christ. Every other cancel culture and restart is bogus replacements of true death with Christ and true resurrection. And we Christians should know that. The world must end where? In Christ. Now, let me ask you something. What is your deepest hope and security? And all those things that are going to end, is that what you listen to most? Is that what's organizing your thoughts most? Is your diagnosis of what's wrong in this world and what will be the solution is from all these things and institutions and voices that will be undone and cease to be when Christ comes back? Is that what's organizing your thinking, your world? Is that what you're championing most? Beloved, why, let me ask you, why would you be organized, defined, and driven by all these things that are not going to be here when Christ comes back? Why would you not think about reality in light of that one institution that will not be obliterated when Christ comes back, which is the church, those who are in Christ? We should think about reality. We should process reality, not in light of all these things that are going to be undone, but that which will endure. Let me read a text that I think is really helpful. 1 Corinthians 1:3. Listen to this. 1:3:11. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is, oh man, oh there it is, which is Jesus Christ. So Christ is the only foundation that will endure. Now, if anyone builds on a foundation with gold, silver, or precious stones, or wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day of the Lord, the end day, will disclose it because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. So basically, God's saying, look, there's going to be a day where what is significant about what you do and your abouts will be disclosed. And what will be the X factor? Well, he already said, only things that are built on the supremacy of Christ and the worldview of Christ will be that which continues. If the work that someone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he will be saved, but only as through fire. So let me paraphrase that. Every single thing that is not done in light of the supremacy of the King Jesus cross and resurrection world will be a big pile of smoke. In the end, all talks about transformation and renovation and hope that is not laid on the foundation of the Son of God will be a glorious pile of ashes one day that speaks nothing. And everything that is Christocentrically gospel defined will endure forever. Because when Christ comes back, he's going to end everything. And only things that will continue will be him. Beloved, you know what's interesting about this text? You know why everyone is excited about it at the end? They're saying, finally, the kingdom of the world will be the kingdom of our Lord. You know what? You know what? You know what we're really excited about? We're not going to be... Isn't it great that things will be economically better and socially better and things that will be physically better and politically better will be? Isn't it great that finally King Jesus will be glorified in every ounce of reality? That's what we want. It's not about us. And this is going to be so great that we have all of these so-called entitlements of humanistic-oriented obsessions. No, it's so great that one day King Jesus will be the center of every glass, every molecule of existence. That's why we're excited. Not about us. It's about the fact that one day King Jesus, when he undoes everything, he will bring his glory on every inch of the globe, truly. Here's the second thing we see about the end. We're looking forward to new creation, not cyberspace. New creation, not cyberspace. Look what it says. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord. Listen very carefully. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord. So that means that this creation is going to be destroyed, but this creation is going to be redone in a new creation. You know what that means? We're not going to be floating around in heaven with harps like spirits worshiping in some eternal choir. We're going to be here with bodies on grass, green trees, and all sorts of stuff eating. We are not going to cyberspace. We are anticipating a new creation, a real physical creation. Now, it's like, yeah, whatever, who cares? But there is something that is always perverted in the church, and it's called Gnosticism. And all of a sudden, like, some of you are like, oh my gosh, those are things that you and Yanni and Rick care about. Like, I don't care about Gnosticism, all right? Can you, like, talk to me about, like, something practical? All right, let me tell you what's important about this. Gnosticism is something that is in the human heart, and basically it's this belief that this world is bad, creation's bad, and spirituality is good. And so what we need to do is escape creation, escape physical creation things, whether it's food or gender. We have to escape this awful creation and enter into this spiritual cyberspace heavenly domain. This is always a problem in the church. It's basically a problem in the church now. And it leads to all sorts of weird stuff. When you don't realize that we are looking forward to an embodied material universe, you do weird things like think you're spiritual because you don't eat food. You have all these weird diets that you think make you spiritual. Prohibition. Why do we have prohibition? Because clearly the problem is not human hearts. The problem is creational things. And so we did prohibition because of all Christians who thought that things are bad. And guess what? It led to all kinds of crime and mafia. It was a really good idea, right? The problem was not alcohol. It was the human heart. The problem is not creation. It leads to us thinking we're only spiritual in devotions and prayer and not in common everyday things like family and vocation and everyday life. It leads us to think, let me get an example of this. I love Jesus in my heart and I worship in my heart, but I live with my boyfriend. See, you can't talk about spiritual purity in your heart while your body is doing something contrary to things, because you're not a cyberspace spiritual person. You're embodied. You tracking with me? It leads to the kind of stuff that we've been hearing all year long. Now listen, I'm not talking about people that for health reasons and their age stay at home to be health conscious. I'm not talking about those people. I'm talking about the church saying, we are the church everywhere. The church is not a gathering. The church is just a bunch of spiritual cyberspace people downloading cyberspace messages. That's the church. Beloved, that's Gnosticism. The church is a place where you go to an actual place with actual people, with actual voices and actual faces, and you see them. It's not a cyberspace realm. Gnosticism says, who cares about going to somewhere? Who cares about local gatherings where there's people? We have this spiritual thing. Beloved, it's the kind of things that make people not listen to the word of God in this book, but listen to some inner word outside of this book that has nothing to do with this book. Why? Because I'm a spiritual cyber being. I don't have time for these fleshly words that are in this book. But beloved, listen, you know what this is saying? When Christ comes back, he's going to bring an actual physical creation. Listen, Jesus took on a body to save us. And guess what? He was raised bodily to save us. And guess what? He still has a body. Think about this. Jesus took on a body. He has a body. He died with a body. He's raised with a body. He has a body because one day we will be bodily raised in an embodied actual creation. We are not looking for escape into cyberspace. We are looking for an embodied creational reality where we taste, touch, and see, and eat, and drink, and have actual bodies. We're not looking for some escape into cyberspace, beloved. This means what you do with your body matters. Jesus says, now Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6, that Jesus Christ died for in his body. Do not use your body for sexual immorality, because the Lord bodily died for your body. Don't buy that lie. Which is why us trying to relate to God in ways that negates reality that is normal and everyday, it's not spiritual. It's actually demonic, beloved. You know what you're hearing right now? Gender is bad. Sexuality is bad. You know, being a man is bad. Why is it that all the chatter is that gender is bad, sexuality is bad, being a man and being distinct as a man is bad? Why is that? Because Satan hates creation. And he wants to sell us the lie that this creation that God made with gender and sexuality and male and female categories and food is bad. And here's the good news, that you can escape this bad created world and recreate yourself with this Gnostic embodied bodiless people. And we say, listen, we are going to a real physical place where we have real bodies, which means creation is good. And the gospel frees us to enjoy good things. Gender is good. Our sexuality as given by God in creation are good. Food is good. The problem is that we are bad. We are looking forward, beloved, to a material eternity. We are looking for a material eternity where we're not going to be cyber drones floating around, but we will be flesh and blood with Jesus, flesh and blood. So therefore, it affects the way we see the present. This is the whole reason why James says, hey, you spiritual people, your brother's hungry and he's, you know. So this is what happens when we don't realize that we're going to a physical eternity. We do things like this. Our brother comes up to us and they're like, man, like, I'm hungry and I'm lacking. And we say, well, you know, Galatians 6:4 says, you know, if thou shalt trust the Lord, and you just treated him like some cyborg, cyberspace downloading thing, he needs you to give him something practical, something basic. Why? Because we are embodied beings, our bodies matter, and we're going to an embodied reality, and so I practically love my brothers with their practical needs, right? Not just see this disconnected, super spatial, abstract thing. We're going to a new creation, not a cyberspace. You follow me? The kingdom of our Lord, the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever. It's the third thing, as we expect. And bear with me and let me listen. Let me say everything before you begin to judge me for this. We are not going to pre-mill purgatory or probation. We're not going to pre-mill purgatory or probation. What do you mean by that? Look what it says. When Christ comes back, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord, and he will reign forever and ever. Now that sounds like when Christ comes back, it's forever and ever. He will be reigning and ruling. There is no other thing to look forward to. When he comes, that's it. We're looking forward to him coming and making things right. Now, just not to get overly theological, but I have to, let me explain to you something about premillennialism so we understand what we're talking about. So premillennialism is this belief that when Christ comes back, he's going to install an earthly kingdom on earth for 1,000 years where God will rule and reign through Christ on earth in this earthly realm. Now, in this conversation, when Christ comes back, there's some people that are really solid and I respect. And I disagree with them, but I respect them. And on the other side of the conversation, there's people that, like, I pray the Lord will save them from their craziness, okay? I mean, the kind of people that think that when Christ comes back, we're going to offer sacrifices for sins. Like, that is the side of the spectrum that is really crazy. And there's a side of the spectrum that's really healthy where we have a healthy disagreement. But I'm a preacher. I preach the text. And when I encounter something, I have to explain it in the way that makes the most sense. And so I have to give my perspective on what I think is most necessary to critique the overall conversation. So let me tell you, what's the problem with us looking forward to some kind of earthly empire where Christ comes back, and yet there's still sin, there's still death, and in the end, there's still a demon? I don't know about you. I don't really look forward to that. If Christ comes back and there's still sin and there's still curse and there's still a devil that eventually leads a whole coup, I don't think that I'm looking forward to that. I mean, you might think that's really good to look forward to, but I don't. Beloved, when Christ comes back, he will reign forever and ever, and there will be no more sin, no more curse, no more death, no more devil. When he comes back, everything will be perfect. But when you begin to look forward to something that's like this, you're basically selling yourself short. You're selling yourself short. Listen, beloved, an earth that's a little bit better but still jacked up is not good to look forward to, right? You don't agree? An earth that is still earthly but not supreme and totally renewed is not something to really look forward to. It's not. Listen, you know what happens? So supposing when Christ comes back, he wipes out all the unbelievers, and the only people that are left are believers, right? It's pretty clear from Revelation. When Christ comes back, he wipes out all unbelievers and all sorts of believers. But guess what? There's still people getting lost, right? So that sounds like purgatory. There's only Christians left. They're living to be 100 years, but somehow they become unchristian. Well, you say, well, they have kids. That's who becomes apostate. Well, Jesus said, in the kingdom that is coming, in the age to come, there is no marriage, right? Remember Jesus said that? In the age that is coming, in the age that is coming, there is no procreation because it has no purpose. So think about this. When Christ comes back, you're going to have a 1,000-year opportunity to potentially lose your salvation. I'm sorry, that's not good news. When Christ comes back, I must be secured in eternity, but not be given a 1,000-year probationary period where I can maybe become apostate. That's not good. Beloved, we're not looking forward to purgatory, where Christ removes every unbeliever, but now believers who are left, they have one more chance to make it to the end of that. That's not good news. Beloved, we are looking for a time not when God will make earthly kingdoms a little bit better, when God will make sin a little bit less, but we're looking forward to perfection and a cosmos that has no sin and no brokenness and no more pain. That's what we're looking forward to. Listen, let me read a text. Let me read a text. There's like one amen in here. Hebrews 12. For they could not bear what was commanded. Verse 21. The appearance was so terrifying that Moses said, I'm terrified and trembling. Instead, you have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, the angels and festival gathering, to the assembly of the spirits of righteous people made perfect. And if you go down to 25, make sure that you don't reject the one who speaks. For if they did not escape the one who warned us from heaven, even less if we turn away from the one who warned us from heaven. Look, listen to verse 26. His voice shook the earth at that time. But now he's promised, yet once more, I will not only shake the earth, but also the heavens. This expression, yes, one more, indicates the removal of what can be shaken, that is created things, so that what will not be shaken might remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us hold on to grace. Listen to that. When Christ comes back, we're going to receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken. But the kingdoms of this age cannot be shaken. It can be shaken. When Christ comes back, he's going to bring something that is perfect. 2 Peter 3:10. Listen to what it says in 2 Peter 3:10, 11. Since these things are going to be destroyed in this way, it is clear what sort of people you should be in holy conduct and godliness. As we wait earnestly and desire the coming of the day of God, the heavens will be on fire. This is when Christ comes back. The heavens will be on fire and be dissolved because of it. The elements will melt with heat. When Christ comes back, he's going to melt reality, not continue reality, all right? But based on his promise, we wait for a new heavens and a new earth where righteousness will dwell. Not where there's still apostates and sin and death and satanic deceptions, but where righteousness dwells and there is no unrighteousness in a new heavens and new earth. I don't look forward to some kind of intermission of sorts that is a little bit better, but still needs to be purged again. Beloved, let me ask you a question. Do you think King Jesus is powerful? Okay, Jesus comes back. He's like, you should feel really good that I'm back, right? I'm back. Oh, Satan's going to rebel against me again. I'm sorry. My Christ, when he comes back in glory, that's it! No more rebellion, no more anarchy. When Christ comes back, he brings every knee to bow. He subverts sin, death, and hell, and the devil at the last trumpet. And there will be no resistance to the king's return. There will be no resistance. There will be no more sin, no more devil, no more apostasy. And there will be no 1,000-year test to see if you can make it in by being good enough in those 1,000 years. Guess what? If you have 1,000 years to fail, you will fail. If you have 2,000 years to fail, you will fail. If you believe in reincarnation, which is not true, and God and you become back to live 1,000 lives, you will fail every time. We are looking forward to the 33 years that take us all the way into the eternal realm because of Christ meeting conditions, not a probationary period where Christ comes back. But hey, some of us are dropping out and not making it to the end. The kingdom of the world has become, not is in an intermissional state of becoming. It has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Messiah, and they will reign forever and ever and ever. Now, we can disagree about this, and we can respectfully disagree about this, and hopefully you could understand why I think that this position matters. I think it matters. Beloved, listen, do you know why we're so obsessed with earthly kingdoms now? Because we're looking forward to some earthly kingdom then. You know why we're so obsessed with earthly kingdoms now? Because we're looking forward to the hope of another earthly kingdom. Beloved, it affects that. What you're looking forward to will affect how you act now. The reason why we're so obsessed with humanistic geopolitical national power is because we're looking forward to another earthly period of earthly power. But if we're looking for a new creation with totally new, renewed power, we're really not impressed or preoccupied with what is earthly now, because what is earthly now will give way to what is ultimate and perfect, not just more earthly power. You follow me? Davis. So listen, this is just some application, all right? Beloved, don't sell for anything less. Don't sell for any other kind of millennial age. So when the socialists come and they offer you their version of the millennium with all their Marxist garbage, say, no, thank you. I got my millennium coming to me and Christ comes back. When the conservatives come with their earthly millennium about Americanity and all this stuff, you say, no, thank you. Thank you. My millennium's coming when Christ comes back and brings a new creation. My hope is not in some millennial glory age in America, but in the new creation. Beloved, when the social justice warriors come with their version of the earthy millennium with all their legalistic laws and systems and ideology, you say, no, thank you, SJ warrior. I'm looking forward to the millennium of the king when he comes back. I don't want your millennium. When the state comes in and makes all these promises about how they're going to be our saviors and bring in this whole new era of greatness, we say, thank you. I'm looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth where righteousness dwells. I'm not looking forward to some earthly improved millennium, because guess what? An improved earthly state still is not good. It's not good. I need Christ to make it perfect or nothing less. When the prosperity wolves come with their version of the earthly millennium, I say, no, thank you. I got my prosperity theology when Christ comes back. You know what's interesting? You know what's really interesting is that when you settle for less in the future, beloved, you'll always feel like you're lacking right now. When you're settling for less of a future, you'll always feel like you're lacking right now. And you will want to make more of the now than it should be. But beloved, listen to me. This text is saying that when Christ comes back, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord, and they will reign forever and ever. No more problems, no more sin, no more apostasy, no more death, no more curse. That's what we should be looking forward to. We should not settle for less. Don't settle for less, beloved. All right, so I got to move on. Two more points, don't worry. I'm not going to preach for 50 minutes. Unless you ask me. We are expecting redemptive reparations. Redemptive reparations. I want to do the alliteration, all right? Look what it says in verse 17. The 24 elders who were seated before the throne on their thrones, that's the church, fell face down and worshiped God, saying, we thank you, Lord God, the Almighty. This is the same scene who was and who was, because you have taken your great power and you've begun to reign. The nations were angry, but your wrath has come. The time for the dead to be judged and give reward to your servants, the prophets, the saints, and those who fear your name. That's us, both small and great. The time has come to destroy those who destroy the earth. Then that sounds like that's time for things to be over and the good stuff to come in the end, right? Right? The time for us to be rewarded. And notice something. It says that there's two kinds of people. Those who are going to be rewarded and those who are going to be judged. That's it. So when Christ comes back, you're either going to be those who are rewarded or you're going to be judged and given justice. Which kind of, there's some people that are saying things like this. Hey, when Christ comes back, Christian, guess what? When Christ comes back, he's going to look at your Christianity. He's going to see how many fruits you had between conversion and the end. And then he's going to count them and let you in. That's something that, have you heard of future grace, future justification? It's something that people are saying. But beloved, listen, when Christ comes back, we're going to be rewarded. We're not going to be sifted through to see how, if we had enough imperfect, sinful works in our regenerate state to make it into heaven. When he comes back, we're going to be rewarded. Why? Because Christ is going to be the one who is rewarded, and we're in Christ. Now, let me read a text that is helpful. Look at this text. We will be judged. But we will be judged not in the way the world will receive judgment for their failures. Look, John 5:24. I assure you, anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not come under judgment, but is passed from death to life. Does that sound simple enough? Let me rewrite it. I assure you, anyone who hears my word and believes in me who sent me has potentially eternal life and will potentially come under judgment depending upon how many works he does as a Christian, but he's passed on a temporary death to temporary potential life. Does that make any sense? No. So just it says, you have eternal life and you will not come under judgment, but you have passed from death to life. When Christ comes back, beloved, you will be rewarded with sweet gospel bliss and everyone else will be judged. Now, why does this matter? Why does this matter? Let me tell you why this matter. If you're honest, Christianity is not really rewarding. Most evangelism we do, I don't know about y'all. If everyone that I evangelize got saved, I would be like I would be like one of these guys on TV. Most people I evangelize to have not received the gospel. Let me get real personal. There's a lot. I've been to Pinelands for 3 months. There's some gangstified servants. Now, gangstified is not a negative term. It's the way young people say something very positive. There are some impressive servants. Okay. And you know what? I guarantee you that you feel totally unappreciated so often. Like, I just do all sorts of things and people just assume it. It's not really rewarding, even though you're doing it very faithfully. Being a gospel-centered parent is not rewarding. I know why parents leave their kids on iPads all day long, because it's really easy to be a gospel-centered parent and not let your kids just become tablet zombies is hard. To, right? Everyone's like, man, I'm one of those people. I get it, man. Beloved, to be godly in your marriage is oftentimes not rewarding. Some of you have lost your marriage for being godly. Being a Christian, being in church, there's not much return. And you know what? I think we could begin to think, like, what's the point? What's the point? Is there a point? Beloved, what this text is saying is that every single thing that you are doing in the name of Jesus, every single thing will be rewarded and enjoyed and supremely and eternally sweet one day. Just wait. There is a gospel redemptive reparation that is coming your way in the end, but in the now, it doesn't seem to be too rewarding, but it's coming, beloved. It's coming. One day, deacons who serve, there's going to be nothing but gratitude for your service. One day, pastors like me who preach and we get bit by sheep and we get rocks thrown at our face and, you know, for speaking the truth sometimes and sometimes for being a little bit questionable, one day there's going to be a sweet blissfulness, uninterrupted. But you know what? The devil's smart. He doesn't want us to look forward to redemptive reparations. He wants us to look for now reparation stuff. Look what happens when the devil goes up to Jesus. Look what happens. If you're the Son of God, Matthew 4:3, command these stones to become loaves of bread. Hey, you're the Son of God. You shouldn't be hungry. Have you ever heard these prosperity liars in Miami say that? You're the Son of the King, right? You shouldn't be struggling. That's the devil. What did Jesus say? Man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that comes out of the mouth of God. And the devil took him on the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of a temple and said to him, if you're the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written. You're the Son, right? Shouldn't you be impressive in the now and rewarded in the now and adored in the now, right? You're the Son, right? If you're really the Son of God, right? He even cites scripture. He will command his angels concerning you, and their hands will bear you up lest you strike your foot against a stone. Jesus again said to him, again, it is written, you shall not put the Lord of God to the test. And again, the devil took him to a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world. Think about that. The devil's saying, all the power in the world, all the power in America, all earthly power. Now, who's saying that? Who's saying, make the kingdoms of the world ours? Now, who's saying that? Lucifer. Just saying. Y'all tracking me? Jesus, you can be the now empire ruler. You can have America and Canada and every other Annika and ever all love you and make you the king now. Jesus says, you shall worship the Lord your God, and only him you shall serve. Now, beloved, here's the thing. Jesus gets all these things eventually, right? But the devil says, no, forget that eternal reward. You deserve something now, right? Look, can I be honest with y'all, with us Americans? We're a bunch of entitled brats. We're always complaining about everything all the time. And my relatives, they don't even know where the bread's going to come from. And we're arguing about whether we can have $10 steak or $20 steak. But beloved, and it comes from this duping of Satan to convince us that we need now satanic reward, now earthly power, now status. And God is saying, listen, I got something coming for you that is joyous and sweet, but it will be then when I come back and when the kings of the world become the kings of Christ, and then I will reward my servants. We don't have anything now, beloved. Listen, if you came to Christ for nowness, then you might as well just leave the faith and become a pagan. You say, Aldo, how can you say that? That's what Paul said. If we accepted Christ for this life only, then we are of all men the most to be pitied. But beloved, we have redemptive reparations. And you know what? I think that there's something really interesting about how one day God will give you the sweetness of in Christ that you never tasted before. You know what? You know what's so cool? I thought about this one time. Can I be honest with you? Being married is really hard, okay? I'm your pastor. Being married is really hard. Rebecca's inside. It's really hard. You know what? One day, my relationship with my wife is going to be absolutely perfect. Not as my wife, but as my sister. One day, we are not going to be bouncing off each other's heads with our selfishness one day. But the devil says, no, your marriage should not be difficult now. I'm going to give you some now reparations. And you know what? You buy it, you burn your marriage to the ground, and you sell, you buy that lie. But beloved, this text is saying that there is an eternal bliss that is coming to every saint. Just wait. And do not let Babylon and the devil, with all of their now reparations, now obsessions, dupe you into anything less. Don't let them dupe you into some earthly kingdom that is not supremely blissful. Don't let them dupe you into now reparations. Beloved, have your eyes fixed on the glory of this day where Christ will come back and he will give you all the things that are due to you, not because of you, but because of Christ and you and him. Don't settle for anything less. Let me say one more thing, beloved. Maybe I will go 50 minutes. I'm sorry. You guys forgive me? You guys absolve me? Beloved, who's going to be rewarded in the end? Who's rewarded? The saints, the prophets, and those who fear God. What does that mean? Saints, it speaks about your identity in Christ. Prophets is those who speak the truth about God. And those who fear God, those who are defined more by who God is and his name than anything else. Listen, in the end, the reward is not going to be, are you black or white? Are you immigrant? Or are you naturally born? That's not going to be the categories, right? Is that the categories? Is the category going to be oppressed or oppressor? Is that going to be who's rewarded or not? Majority or lack of majority? Is the category going to be, you know, this color or that color? Is the category going to be American or, you know, non-American? Is the category going to be Democrat or Republican? Are those the categories? What are the categories? Are you a saint who fears God or not? Now, why is that important? This is why it's important. Because right now, the culture around us and the church is sucking us into these categories. They want us to play the game where all these humanistic categories are defining us. And God is saying, listen, in the end, there's only two categories that matter. Are you in Christ and fear God or not? That's all that matters. So why are we going to get duped into this less categorical obsession that the culture is sucking us into? We have, understand, the biggest categories in the end, right? Listen, Democrats and Republicans are both going to be in hell. Black and white and brown and everything in between will both be in hell. But who will be in heaven? The prophets who are saints in Christ and fear God's name. Shouldn't that be what really defines us now? That's what's going to, listen, my in Jesus hat is the only thing that's going to take me to heaven. Every other hat will not take me to heaven. There is redemptive reparations for those who are the saints who fear God. I heard some Baptist preacher say there's the saints and the ain'ts. Beloved, I love you. Please don't let lesser categories make you supremely defined. Please. The most important thing about you is not that you're a man or a woman, that your pigment is this or that, that you got more money or less money, that you voted for this guy or that guy. Those things are significant. They matter. But what's most important about you is that you're in Christ. Amen? You're in Christ. That's your eternal hat. That's your eschatological ultimate end time hat. All right. I have one more point. I'm sorry. So the culture is going to end, not continue. New creation, not cyberspace. No purgatory or probation in the end, but a final bliss of perfection. We're going to be rewarded redemptively in the end, not in the beginning or before. But here's one last thing. I got two U's. Unconditional ultimacy. Remember that? Unconditional ultimacy. Look what it says at the last verse in this chapter. God's sanctuary in heaven was open, and the Ark of the Covenant appeared in his sanctuary. There were flashes of lightning, rumbling of thunder, and an earthquake and a severe hail. Now, like, you may ask, like, okay, why in the very last phase of reality we see the Ark opened up in heaven? Well, John is using Old Testament pictures to bring us into New Testament reality. So how many of you guys remember, how many of you Bible nerds remember when the Ark was revealed in an important thing in the Bible? Come on. Joshua, right? In the book of Joshua, they walked around for 7 days, and with the Ark exposed and revealed, the walls fell down and God's people went into the promised land, right? So John is basically saying that that ark had meaning that was only understood in Christ. So what was in the ark? The mercy seat that had the place where the blood would be spilt, and it had the law of God. So you know why those walls fell down? It's not because there's some magical power in that little box. It's because that box pointed to the altar where Jesus Christ would be slaughtered for his people as sinners. The law had the altar had the law of God that Christ himself would keep entirely for his people. And because they were trusting in what that pointed to Christ, they entered into the promised land, not because of their morality, not because of their goodness, not because of their effort, but they entered the promised land because the ark points to God's promises and actions in Christ. They went into their hopeful place because of the ark that brought the walls down. Nothing in them brought the walls down. Now, you see where John is going with this? Where's John going with this? Okay, we're going to our ultimate promised land. And guess what? The reason why everything in between us and eternity and the new Jerusalem and the final new creation, the reason why we're going to go to heaven one day is because Christ met all the conditions for us, and he knocked down the walls of sin, death, and hell, and the devil. And because he is the ark who knocked down the walls against us, we're going home because of Christ alone. That's the whole point, that this is at the last scene of Revelation chapter 11. When you see the end and where you're going, guess what? You're going there because Christ punched in your ticket. Beloved, everything else in life is different, though. Listen, if you want to be healthy, then work out. Otherwise, you won't be healthy. Go talk to Jamie and Kim about that, you know? If you want to have money, then work hard. If you want to have a nice home, then call Rebecca up and tell her to rearrange it. You want to, you see where it goes. Everything on the ground, beloved, is conditional. But don't get it twisted. We're going to heaven because Christ, our ark, met the conditions to bring us through this world to the next. That's why we're going there. You have your goal and destiny punched because Christ met all the conditions for you. So at the end of reality, we have this unveiling of the ark, which points to God's grace and what he did for you to bring you all the way home, not into some lesser promised land, but into the new creation. This is the last thing that's open at the end. Beloved, our story, how many of you guys are familiar with the American immigrant story? Some of your parents say this stuff, right? I came to this country with nothing. I worked for a living and now I'm successful. How many of you are familiar with the old money story? Who knows what old money is? It means like your family always has money, always will have money, and you have money now because you're part of old money, right? Beloved, we're not the immigrant coming to America story. We're the old money story. Everything that's coming to us ultimately is because of Christ and nothing else. So let me close with this. I'm really going to close, I promise. Beloved, don't let somebody give you their own version of how to knock the walls down to take you to some kind of promised land. Listen to me. Don't let somebody else give you some kind of lesser promised land and some kind of deconstruction narrative for some kind of hope now. Beloved, you know what I think? You know what I think is interesting about all the people that are destroying like monuments and statues? You know what they're doing? They're saying, I need some kind of promised land, and the way I'm going to do it is by destroying these historical things. Destruction for some kind of hopeful future, right? And you know, if you think about it, we humans do that in a million different ways. I'm looking to some promised land, so I gotta deconstruct, you know, gender. I gotta deconstruct, you know, like, you know, marriage. I gotta deconstruct, you know, sexuality. I gotta deconstruct like the particular political system. I gotta deconstruct that and tear that down because I'm looking for a promised land. I gotta tear something down. I gotta tear down my all the things in my closet. I gotta tear down societal differences and what. I gotta tear down the Constitution. I gotta tear down, you know, this. I gotta tear down that. I gotta tear down sinners. I gotta tear down this because I'm looking to get into some kind of promised land. And listen, beloved, that's a counterfeit of the gospel. We don't have that kind of promised land hope. Jesus was torn down 2,000 years ago. And because Christ was torn down by his Father, that is the deconstruction of Christ and him being brought down by the Father's wrath. That's what takes us to our promised land. Deconstructing nothing else will do nothing. Am I making sense? Deconstructing nothing else will bring us ultimate hope. Only Christ being deconstructed on the cross for us will give us home. It's not knocking down masculinity. It's not knocking down sexuality. It's not knocking down, beloved, it's only Christ is the ark that takes us to our resting place. Beloved, the difference between our faith and everything else is that every promised land that is promised in humans means that we have to destroy somebody to bring in hopefulness. Our kingdom is about the fact that Christ was destroyed to bring us into his kingdom. He doesn't destroy his enemies to bring the kingdom. He is destroyed for us and he brings us in. Beloved, I love you. Please don't listen to all these cheap, counterfeit, deconstructive narratives for some bogus promised land. We have the Ark of the Covenant, which shows us how we enter into our eternal bliss. No other deconstruction, no other tearing down of anything will give us ultimate hope. Amen? Let me pray. Father, I pray that you please help us to consider our future. Consider, God, that we're going to a real place, not some cyberspace, floaty, disconnected reality. But we're going to see each other face to face. See you face to face. I pray you would help us to not settle for some kind of a little bit better earthly empire, but it's still jacked up and broken. I pray, God, that we would not settle for all these humanistic reparations about now glory, but we would long for the betterness of what you give us then in Christ. And Father, I pray that we would realize that it is because of the unconditional things you give us, because of what happened to Christ, the true Ark of the Covenant, the true mercy seat, the true law keeper, that we will be brought into our ultimate promised land. Father, help us to look to a biblical future that's Christ-centered and ultimate. Amen.